Good afternoon. Good afternoon. And I'll say good afternoon once more, although I don't need to, because you're all very attentive today. And it's so nice to have you all back for the second semester of our World Affairs luncheons. It's good to see old friends and new as we restart the quest for understanding the world and our American place in that world. Life becomes ever more complex. Our interdependence with others, from next door to neighbors to nature to nations, becomes more obvious. Our safety and security more uncertain, and our politics more puzzling. For those reasons and more, I'm delighted and in fact relieved to welcome back today's speaker to the Schemel Forum. The world is changing at a breathtaking pace, and we need the ballast that will stabilize us in this rapidly changing world, moving world. The ballast, one might say, resides in a robust civil society. We need to increase our awareness of the central role that citizens play in making democracy work, and we need to increase our commitment to being players in our society. Mike Edwards can show us the way. He has paid his dues by working in leadership roles at such institutions as Oxfam, Save the Children, the World Bank, and the Ford Foundation. He knows the world of service and philanthropy, and is now using that knowledge to help us figure out what we as citizens must do to ensure that our government is one that is of, for, and by the people, to guide us in using our freedom wisely by keeping social justice at the forefront of our minds and hearts. Please join me in welcoming Mike Edwards.
Thank you, Sandra, and I'm delighted to be back. Thanks for inviting me. I thought it was going to be snowy, but of course it wasn't. So I was a bit fearful. Also, I broke three ribs, as Sandra knows. A month or so ago in a fall, so completely my fault, fell off the roof thinking I was clever. So actually this is my first exposure to the world outside since it happened. I've been sort of sheltering myself, so this chair is here to catch me, just in case I start to get a little bit tired. So if I do sit down, I'm not being rude, it's just that I may need to do that because I'm not quite healed yet. But one of the many reasons I like coming back to Scranton is because I can drive it from my home in the Catskills, the other side of the Delaware River. I come through Honesdale and down the virtually empty Route 6, which is always one of my favorite roads because there's one car going this way and two cars going this way until you get here to Scranton. It's fantastic. And the story I want to tell you today, or share with you today, does start back at home in Johnny's Barber Shop, to be exact, a place called Livingston Manor, if you know it, just off Route 17. In Sullivan County, where I have my hair cut, $10 for the cut, the gossip is free, Johnny says. So that's sort of a good deal. And I'm sitting in the chair having my hair snipped. Suddenly I hear behind me a conversation between two guys who are waiting their turn about the Elks and the Lions Club, bemoaning the fact how difficult it is to get kids to join these institutions these days. Our numbers are dwindling, they were saying. We don't know whether we're going to survive. Do we need to survive? Does it matter? What's the point, so to speak? And you have to remember, normally in the barber shop, I'm like a sort of fish out of water, because as you can tell from my accent, I'm not from New York or Pennsylvania. And I don't read the Guns and Ammo magazines that are piled up in the corner. And I can't take part in conversations about how to change the spark plug on your log splitter, which is usually what the guys are talking about, waiting for the turn. I don't know whether log splitters have such things, you'll have to tell me, but you get the feeling. But here, right in my own community, I was listening to the story of my life's work, essentially, which, as Sandra says, has been the study of how lots of different kinds of voluntary clubs and societies and social movements and labor unions and non-profits and community groups and foundations and so on. Why and how do they matter in the larger scheme of things, in creating the kind of societies that we can be proud of? Are they just a sort of footnote? Who cares really whether the Elks or the Moose or the American Legion rise or fall? it doesn't really matter. But the case I'm going to try and make to you today is that it really does matter, not just for this country, but for every country which has a civil society. It matters greatly. I call that whole amalgamation of kinds of groups civil society. It's a convenient shorthand for the whole tapestry of voluntary associational life that we're all a part of in one way or the other. It doesn't really matter whether one particular organisation disappears over time in that very rich tapestry, because there are always new ones emerging, fashions change, society moves on, and so on. But I do think history tells us that what happens in civil society is important for that trajectory of democracy and equality, for freedom and human fulfilment, for the pursuit of peace and social progress, for all the things actually that matter to us in our wider lives. I mean, clearly the way we work together, associate together, is not the only, or you could say even the most important influence on any of those things. But as I hope to show you, it does deserve more attention than we commonly give it. Because as soon as you ignore it, as soon as you let it lie, as soon as you don't start to pay attention to it, it starts to wither on the vine, and then it's too late, because you've lost something that you find difficult to recreate. Now, some theorists do posit a very clear and simple causal relationship between the size and strength of associations and the achievement of these much bigger social and economic goals like poverty reduction and political stability. I don't actually buy that. I think that's too neat and tidy, too simplistic. And you'll hear some of that scepticism and messiness coming through in my remarks. I think that the whole situation is much more complicated and fluid. But it is useful, I think, to organise this discussion around one particular question, and it's this one. How does a strong civil society, in the sense of a rich and diverse tapestry of connections among its citizens, help to create societies that are strong and civil in the broader sense, that they are more egalitarian, more prosperous, harmonious, compassionate, and free? Everything I've studied in my life, or done really, has been organised around that question. So what I want to do today, very briefly, obviously, because I only have half an hour or so, and with a broad brush, is to look back, using that question as a guide, through recent history in the United States over the last 100 years or so, and then look forward on the basis of what's happening in civil society now to see whether that gives us any hints about the challenges that lie ahead. So looking back, the good news is that we have a wealth of good, solid historical analysis, social and political science about these issues. It's not by any means complete or conclusive. And like all social science, it suffers from many biases concerning who produced it, race, gender, class, and so on. But what it tells us, very broadly speaking, is this. After the Civil War and up to the middle of the 20th century or thereabouts, I'm talking the end of the 1950s, there was a measurable explosion of voluntary associations in America, which seems to have been important in consolidating democracy and shared public norms, and which in turn helped to underpin quite a long period, or periods, because of course there was the Great Depression and other things in the meantime, of relative stability, relatively shared prosperity, and declining inequality, income inequality, all bearing in mind that the US was heavily segregated, of course, by race throughout that period, and that racial segregation was carried through into the structures of civil society that we're going to be talking about. Nevertheless, the expansion of membership-based, cross-class, cross-geography, multi-interest voluntary associations, like parent-teachers associations, women's clubs, labour unions, those ELKs that I talked about from the barbershop, supported a high degree of popular involvement in the nation's social and political affairs. In 1910, for example, just to give you a taste of what was happening, there were already over 1 million members of the National Federation of Women's Clubs. By 1955, 9% of all adult Americans were members of a PTA, an organization that had grown out of the earlier National Congress of Mothers. And 12%, think of that, were active in a labor union compared to what we have today. By today's standards, because the population was much lower, these represent huge numbers of people coming together, meeting, and acting collectively, huge numbers. So why is that important? It's important because these groups and networks help to animate debates, just like this one that we're having, conversations in the public sphere about the great issues of the day. They provided avenues for leadership development and accountability from the bottom up so that ordinary Americans, horrible terms, none of us are ordinary, but you know what I mean, regular Americans were not simply governed by elites. Acting on their behalf, they were able to participate directly, to rise through the system as office holders themselves to the national level. And these networks helped to cement at least some form of consensus across political and religious interests and identities about the required direction for society. Where do we want this country to go? What is the future direction for America? Differences never disappear completely because they're deeply rooted inside us in terms of our religious beliefs and so on. But there was enough of a consensus to hold together to provide a supportive platform for the federal government to pass measures like the GI Bill, 1944, which had hugely beneficial, broadly based welfare effects, in that case, as you know, by providing free college education for returning soldiers and sailors and airmen. There are many other examples of that process. But there was something important going on in these structures of society where people came together and decided that there are some issues that we can all get together and agree on, and we want our government to do something about it. And when government responded, there was a very large scale, hugely generally beneficial effect on the well-being of people in society, sort of how we thought politics should operate in the old days. So how did that happen? It happened because when you think about it, here's another good example for us today. When people meet and they form groups and they organize and they get together, what do? They talk, they argue, they may disagree, but they keep talking, they argue, and if, at least if they want to keep working together, which most voluntary groups do, because that's the whole point, to keep things going, you have to figure out some common ground, right? Even if you're sitting next to someone who doesn't look like you, or doesn't vote like you, or doesn't go to the same church as you do. Like rocks in a stream, the sharp edges of our differences are worn down, if you like, as we rub against each other in those voluntary associations. They're still there, but they're much smoother. Compare that to, as we were talking about around our table, the levels of polarization that exist in political conversation today, where it's pretty much impossible to envisage a consensus about anything important, and so society as a whole can't move forward in that same way. As we'll see later, that's partly because today civil society has itself become fractured along many political and partisan lines, so no longer provides that same consensus-making function. As a segue to my next point, it's important to remember that the GI Bill was also a measure which helped many future leaders of the civil rights movement and other social movements to improve their knowledge, their confidence, their organising skills, their contacts and so on. Now that's interesting because I'm segueing here to the next period in history. From the mid-1950s to around the mid-1970s, the United States took a shift and witnessed a pretty historic, actually, expansion of social movements for equal rights, based initially around race and then gender, somewhat later around sexual orientation, along with peace and anti-war protests, the beginnings of the environmental movement, and efforts to promote international solidarity around the nuclear arms race, Central America, other global issues, and so on. And these civil society formations were very different in character because movements are more adversarial, aren't they? They're more antagonistic. They are often single issue or identity based. That's where they get their strength and passionate commitment. They're led directly by people from the communities who are suffering injustice themselves. But nevertheless, they shared something in common with those older style groups, and that is that they enlisted millions of Americans in civic and political action, and they won vital, if incomplete, victories in terms of equality of different kinds. Most of those movements, however, began to run out of steam in the next period of history, from about the mid-1970s to the early 2000s, if you remember that time. What happened was that they were replaced, by and large, by more highly professionalized advocacy groups and NGOs or non-profits like the ACLU, the Sierra Club, examples like that. They had lots of legal and policy expertise, but they had much smaller memberships, if they had any members at all. They had virtually no internal democracy. They didn't operate in that same sense. And they had much weaker connections to the grassroots, to communities, or to any working class or multi-issue constituencies. And scholars like Theda Scotchall, who was at Harvard, are critical of the hollowing out of civil society that they think this caused during that period. She calls it diminished democracy, what happened during that period, and she links it very specifically to the trends towards rising inequality, concentrated power and political polarisation, which you remember began to emerge or be strengthened around that same time. We're talking 1970s, 1980s. So there you see a classic example of the links that I mentioned at the beginning between the changing structure of civil society and its outcomes in the larger spheres of life. Now, of course, you can make a counter-argument, some people have, that these advocacy groups achieved solid progress on equal rights and the environment precisely because they were more professional in the narrower sense of the word. They really knew what they were doing in that sense. They could move faster, they could pursue a more focused agenda, they could argue their case more persuasively in court and so on. Precisely because, why? Because they didn't have to mobilise and satisfy and listen to and respond to those messy human beings, those millions of members who make your life, you know, so complicated if you're trying to get something done. Because people will always say, well, I don't agree, so we're going to have to talk about it. Okay, you know, let's get things done. You know, that's the sort of mood of the advocacy group. And in fact, it is true that more socially progressive legislation was adopted in the United States during the 1970s and 1980s than in the 25 years following the end of World War II. Presumably that's a good thing. But I'll come on into a moment something I think valuable was lost from earlier times in the move from membership-based civil society to advocacy-based civil society, which cemented itself by the end of the 1980s. And that something did affect the ability of ordinary people to participate in and shape society directly, rather than being shaped, if you like, by the structures of society, which is what the advocacy universe tended to do. So moving on to the final stage, by the end of the 2000s, civil society in America had become a sort of amalgam, a multi-layered amalgam of all these different kinds of voluntary associations interacting with the others. But the dominant trend by far, I think, was the one that emphasised professionalisation. Some critics go further and say it was a bureaucratisation, an increasing sense of bureaucracy in the voluntary world. Some would even call it corporatisation, the fact that voluntary organisations started to mimic the hierarchies of the business world and the way business operates. I'll come to that point a little later. It's not a comment on the value of business, it's a comment on how businesses tend to operate as opposed to less hierarchical voluntary groups. And it was certainly true that the decline of those national mass membership groups continued apace, except in the sphere of evangelical religion, evangelical Protestant religion, which of course has seen a renaissance over the last 20 years or so, and does, I think, qualify as a civil society group. So we'll set that example apart because it's quite complicated to go into. Maybe we can talk about it later. So I'll just give you some figures. Union membership has fallen by 50% since 1945. PTAs have lost 60% of their members in the same period. Groups like the Masons have gone even further and lost 3/4 of their members in that same period. And many other examples of the same kind. In essence, that's what my neighbours were complaining about, were bemoaning, at the back of Johnny's barbershop. The point I want to make at this stage is not necessarily that these trends are good or bad in and of themselves, but that different forms of collective action have different characteristics and effects. And we have to understand those effects if we're going to make any sense of civil society in the future. So that's my segue into the second half of my remarks, which are going to focus on looking forward. And when we look forward, I see at least three big trends emerging in the United States that complicate and enrich this picture even further. The first, most obvious, you'd expect me to talk about this, is the rise of social media, information technology and so on. No surprise there. Second, maybe slightly more surprising, is the blurring of boundaries that's taking place between civil society, government and business. Almost as though the three are merging, or at least intermarrying, let me put it that way, in some very interesting, in some ways quite threatening ways. And the third is the rise of some surprising new social movements in the United States that don't look the same as the movements of the past, and perhaps offer us some guidance, some hope for the future about how we can integrate all of this stuff back together again in a positive way. So let me look first at the social media revolution. much hyped, of course, perhaps overly emphasised, for reasons I'll come on to in a moment, but undoubtedly important. We would be foolish to ignore what's happening in terms of new information and communications technologies like the internet, the World Wide Web, cell phones, tablets and so on, because they've already proved their worth, at least in making certain aspects of organising in civil society easier and smoother and quicker and cheaper, especially across geographical boundaries, if not, interestingly enough, boundaries of issue or identity or politics. Why? Because people tend to congregate in like-minded communities, whether that they take shape on or offline. The internet, unfortunately, doesn't change that fact. If one looks at research on the sort of social characteristics of the internet, you find people clustered together in closely knit communities based on political beliefs, religion, or whatever stance in society. There's almost no one, as someone once said to me, who has a website for the common good on the internet. It's always one particular slice of the common good, argued for very persuasively. Anyway, you've all heard claims, I'm sure, about Facebook revolutions in the Middle East, or the idea that technology changes everything, right? That we're into a bold new frontier. Nothing will ever be the same. There's no going back. This will determine our future. The future is about machines, algorithms, software code. It's not really about human beings interacting. And I think for civil society, that's quite a challenging perspective, because it's always been a human story rather than a sort of technical story. So what does that mean to us? Where are we going? It's perhaps that sense of excitement that social media breeds, especially among younger people, that's driving them away from those traditional civil society groups, like the Lions and so on, into new, frankly more exciting, but also easier forms of virtual voluntary action. But when you look into the research, are these claims true? What's actually happening? Well, yes, to some extent. New information technologies have definitely strengthened and facilitated communications in the non-profit universe. But of course, by itself, that doesn't decide the impact of civil society on the problems it seeks to address. I'll give you a sort of somewhat counterintuitive example. 93% of interactions between people at the height of the Egyptian protests in Cairo's Tahrir Square a few years ago, do you remember that ill-fated popular revolution, took place through face-to-face direct contact between individual people. 93%. This was supposed to be the Facebook revolution par excellence. Only 13% of those interactions took place on social media. There's a discrepancy because social media is measuring Twitter rather than, you know, something, a broader universe. So the 13, the 93 don't add up, but they give you a sense of what was going on. The Facebook revolution never happened in those terms. It wasn't that people weren't using Facebook. We all use Facebook, right? Or most of us do. I do. I mean, it's, you know, okay as a sort of basic functioning tool when I want to connect with people. But we don't organise our political and civic lives around Facebook, by and large. That's the difference. So it's very important to have a sense of perspective about the impact of social media on patterns of voluntary activity. It's even been argued, and I suppose this is where I stand a little bit myself, that the shift from real to virtual organising might actually be weakening the influence of civil society in some respects by watering down the likelihood of direct action and encouraging what's been pejoratively described as slacktivism. Horrible word, isn't it, to be a slacktivist? You know, a slacker and an activist combined. But it sort of gives you gives you an image of what that might look like. Why is that? Well, it's, you know, because engagement via the web or your cell phone by clicking your mouse on your computer is a damn sight easier if you want to sign a petition or retweet someone's message, you know, in a campaign, than the real thing. And when you've done the real thing, as probably most of us have at one point or another, if you've organised an actual meeting, if you've had a debate in your community, if you've lobbied for your political representative, if you've been threatened by someone in power because of your beliefs, all the things that are routine, if you like, as a citizen in civil society, you know that it's not easy. It takes a certain set of human characteristics and moral courage to do that. So why not just sit on the couch and click if someone promises that you can achieve the same? It's very seductive, right? It's very attractive. I'm overdoing the critique a little bit to get the point across, but you can see where I'm where I'm heading. I recently wrote an article where I said, the headline was, "You might follow me on Twitter, but will you follow me to jail? Was the sort of tagline, because it sort of tried to express that sense of difference. Because my conclusion was you can do both, given that I'm a reasonable sort of person, which is what I believe, you can do both. But there is a danger of one displacing the other. It's also a problem, social media, potentially, because the divisions that exist inside civil society, whether they're based on politics or religion or gender or whatever anything else, could actually harden. Because, as I said, there's very little activity on the web that seems to be successful in drawing people together into a sort of unified whole, into a traditional community, or like those older style civil society groups that I talked about a while ago. In fact, when you look at the comments on websites and so on, what you usually see, unless you're very fortunate, is horrific. The slanging match, what's called trolling, people deliberately finding websites or people they don't agree with and leaving nasty comments underneath, very ad hominem, nothing to do with the article, but all about the person. So there are lots of people out there who are deliberately surfing the internet to find people who they know they disagree with to attack them personally. When you think about it, you sort of think, well, how did we get to that position? The sort of inverse of where we sort of should be if we take a civically minded perspective. I publish a website called Transformation, and I'm consistently shocked when I look at the comments on really quite sort of mild, well-meaning articles that they manage to raise such venom, you know, such a toxic atmosphere. So I spend half of my time deleting them. You know, one of my jobs as the publisher is to make sure that anything that is abusive or doesn't follow our commenting guidelines is deleted. But I'm deleting all the time. There's hardly a comment that you want to keep because it doesn't add to the sense of discussion. And as we've seen from recent encounters between presidential hopefuls who will remain nameless and partyless, the level of political debate also seems to have sunk to a sort of all-time low, where we simply sort of shout at each other across the podium and think that this is a substitute for meaningful political conversation. And maybe there's something about the sheer freedom that social media gives you, the freedom of the web to say whatever you want to whomever you want, whenever you want, under the cloak of anonymity. You know, in a civil society organization, you and I have to face each other. If I have something that I want a bone to pick with you, then I will sit down with you and tell you. I won't go onto a website, invent a pseudonym for myself, attack you in a comment under an article you've written, and then sort of scuttle away into cyberspace. That doesn't work. But if you and I sit down and we have a beef, then we'll try and work it out. But you only do that face to face. You can't do it on social media. You can't do it electronically. Human beings don't work that way. The web, remember, has no restrictions, has no filters. So it probably encourages all of these processes that I'm talking about because of the technologically the way it's designed. So in this sense, technology is not a particular positive. It actually may be a negative. So unlike in those older style PTA-like groups or in the social movements of the 60s and 70s, human beings are not actually facing each other physically in dialogue and deliberation, and so those sharp edges of our differences are not being rubbed down over time, as the theory would predict. The web, in the jargon of Silicon Valley, the tech titans, has what they call a frictionless quality. You'll often hear that term. Silicon Valley always wants to reduce friction, whether it's in technology, in the economy, in politics, in society, and so on, meaning they want to reduce the costs of engagement, right? Because that means it's more efficient. By removing human beings from the equation and replacing them with tech solutions, but we do actually need friction in society, so long as that is channeled in positive directions. I mean, getting to yes, which is our objective, getting to some consensus, is only possible by going through a lot of no's first, you know? Because if you pretend that everyone agrees, you're going nowhere. But if you get stuck in disagreement, you're going nowhere either. So you do need some friction, and civil society groups sort of are essential in providing that friction. They are the sort of infrastructure which creates friction of a good kind, mostly, in society. And in some ways, those slows things down. And I think in these times where speed is of the essence, where people are almost obsessed with getting the transactions costs of every process down as far as they possibly can, slowing things down is deeply unattractive. You've probably heard of the slow food movement from Italy, where you actually have to sit down and eat with each other slowly and talk. Well, there's now a slow democracy movement, which I recommend a real movement, actually, for slow democracy in the United States, which recognizes that fact. So, the second important trend on the horizon is this blurring that I mentioned of boundaries between non-profits, government, and the market. Nowadays, and I'm sure this is true in Scranton, it's certainly true where I live, many non-profits are really just service delivery operations on contract to state and federal government departments. They provide health services, education services, rehabilitation, workforce training. Nothing wrong with any of those things. But it does change the character of the organization because you have to become a more efficient and therefore in some ways more hierarchical, more organized, and certainly less grassrootsy, less certainly democratic, movement-oriented organization, because you're supplying health services to large numbers of people, and you're accountable up the system to the service provider, whether that's in Philadelphia or Scranton or Washington, D.C. Charities are increasingly urged to become more like a business, to expand their commercial revenues, their customer base, in inverted commas, or to develop like hybrid institutions. You've probably heard the word social enterprise or social entrepreneur to convey the sense that you can be both a sort of civil society activist and a successful business at the same time. Or L3C or benefit corporations, which internalize social and environmental criteria in their decision making. These are groups that are emerging, if you like, on the boundaries between civil society and the marketplace, or civil society and government in relation to service provision. It's almost as though old style voluntary organizations have gone out of fashion and are actually frowned on, are seen as backward or second rate or no longer necessary. That's definitely the image of charity these days. If you mention charity, if you use the word charity, if I use that word in my conversations about this stuff, people look at me as though I'm crazy, although I'm back, or I'm backward. You know, charity. God. You're still interested in charity? Fuddy-duddy, you know, boring, old-fashioned. And we forget where charity comes from. Caritas, you know, caring for each other, compassion, love. The kind of society we're trying to build with each other is founded on charity, but now it's become, not quite sure about charity, you know. Can't I be a social enterprise or social media? So there's that sort of feeling. The hope from enthusiasts is that this process of blending and blurring will make civil society groups more efficient and will increase their scale and impact. The fear, on the other side, is that it will distance them even further from their constituents and erode the traditionally separate virtues and principles of voluntarism, public service, solidarity and cooperation, the things that in the past have deliberately differentiated civic groups from the bureaucratic authority of government and the commercial competitive values of the marketplace. It was, until quite recently, believed that the best way forward was the so-called three-legged stool, business or the market, government, civil society, roughly equal so they could hold each other in tension. No one was dominant, no one set of forces could make all the decisions. Everyone had to be accountable to the other. Distribution of powers and authority, which, as you know from the Constitution, has good roots here in the United States. That increasingly is seen, I'm afraid, as another idea to be thrown on the scrap heap, as increasingly irrelevant. But is it worth thinking about? The way I'm asking the question gives you my particular answer, because I'm a bit of a traditionalist in that sense. I do think that countervailing forces in society are probably a better way forward than pretending that everyone can be part of the same thing, which I think is disingenuous. But the enthusiasts say no, Mike. You know, these changes release a powerful new cocktail in American society, the perfect mix of social and economic objectives, the perfect margarita, I called it once. But then I thought, well, what about if it turns out to be like oil and water? You know, what if it doesn't mix at all? What if you're trying to mix together two fundamentally different substances? What happens then? I say that partly because my own experience of working in this field is that money and financial incentives and the marketplace usually turn out to be, sadly, you might say, stronger influences than altruism or public service, especially in times of austerity and widespread economic stress for most American families when times are really tough. Money is the real bottom line, even though we might pretend otherwise. So you might start out by wanting to balance all these things together equally, but in practice, money, finance, commercial objectives and so on tend to start to dominate over time because they're just more tangible and immediate, and people need that to survive. So there's a skeptical note. Thirdly, my third and final trend. We're seeing the rise of, as I said, of new social movements, which have the potential at least to break up and rearrange these elements of collective action in new ways. I think a Black Lives Matter will be an obvious one that we've probably all heard about over the last year or so, making change at Walmart, Podemos in Spain, parts of the Arab Spring, the anti-austerity protesters in Greece, among many others. I'm not romanticising these movements. They have many, many weaknesses and failings. If you look at Greece today, you can see what I mean by failings, or even Egypt, or certainly Syria. But what they do have is the potential to reverse that long-term trend towards professionalisation, elite control, and hollowing out that's been a consistent feature of civil society's evolution over the last 50 years. So to me, what's most interesting is not just that they represent a return to the past, if you like, in some sense, but they are actively embracing as much of the new as they possibly can. They are not simply turning their backs on innovations in social media or social enterprise or anything like that. They're saying, well, okay, that's interesting. You know, let's have a look and let's see how we can integrate the good stuff in these new developments into our traditional ways of working. That's a form of blending that might be really, really interesting, because they are by and large led by people from the groups that suffer injustice, instead of by professionals who act on their behalf. And they are by and large prepared to take on, to stand up and call out in quite a courageous way those who they see are responsible for racism or rising inequality directly. But they also harness the power of those new innovations, and they look always to integrate everything together into a way which is mutually supportive and harmonious. I think that's actually quite exciting for the future. Maybe something of a model. Making change at Walmart, for example, does a lot of organising online via social media, because that's the only way you can contact millions of people at once. But then it goes to actual individual Walmart stores on the ground and works with people in the stores and in the community on alternative economic development, on rules and regulations, on community benefit agreements, on all sorts of things which are very familiar from old-style community action. So that's a good example of how you put the two things together. On the other hand, these movements tend to lack a detailed policy agenda and a strategy for long-term political engagement, and that will surely hold them back in the long run. Anyone remember Occupy? Right, a good example. A couple of years ago, you remember people started to camp out in Wall Street to bring attention to rising inequality, but then the movement sort of fizzled out. It had no plan, it had no strategy, and that's the difference with those older style civil society networks. They had plans, they had structures, and you had to get messages from the grassroots to Washington DC and had to make those messages stick in the political process. So that's something that has to be worked on if they don't fizzle out either. These groups are also, I think, less interested in dialogue with people who don't agree with them. There's a sort of snarkiness, you know, almost a sense of, you know, if you're not with me, you're against me. And that makes it difficult, I think, to reach out and help in recreating a social consensus on issues like climate change or healthcare reform, which we know are going to continue to be divisive because Americans don't agree on them. So it's not a case that a social movement can simply win in a simplistic way. There has to be negotiation, and these movements are not particularly good at negotiation. So we can't afford to be romantic, we have to be rigorous. And when we're rigorous, it's clear that there are both positive and negative elements, threats and opportunities, if you like, in each of those three trends that I've outlined. And it's too soon to know which of the forces, whether it's the positive or the negative, will win out over the longer term, since we're still very much at the stage of trying to sort out the hype from the substance. It's clear to me, however, that the ways in which these new forces interact with each other and the traditions of civil society in the past will go a long way towards deciding the answer to the question that I raised at the beginning. The key question that I'm going to sort of move to a conclusion here to leave you with is what I would call, sounds a bit jargony, but I'll explain it, is the key question is one of complementarity or substitution. In other words, will all of these different elements that I've talked about, these different traditions of organising, be blended together successfully in order to strengthen citizens overall? Will they be complementary? Will they build on each other? Or will the new displace the old? Will it push the old aside in ways that weaken forms of collective action that remain critical for all of our futures? That's the question that keeps me up at night. And to be honest, I'm not very certain or sanguine about the future. I do believe, though, going back to my image of being a traditionalist, that we can learn more from the past than we often admit to, and that the new has to be subjected to more critical scrutiny than we're comfortable with. And if we can do both of those things, then we'll get closer to answering the questions that I've been raising today. What does the future hold? You know, what are we going to be talking about in Johnny's barbershop in 50 or 100 years' time? Well, I think we know part of that answer. The elks and the lions and so on will have disappeared completely. They'll be very unlikely that they will be able to survive and renew themselves, unless something happens that I'm not aware of. But it's just as likely that new kinds of media and market-savvy, social movement-oriented civic activists will have taken over. That's the optimistic reading of the fact that we are social creatures, right? Or at least most of us are, apart from the sociopaths, which there are none in this room, I'm sure. But we like getting together. We like organising. We form things. We like organising. We like standing for things. We like holding offices. We like electing. We like arguing. Those are all the part of the things deep in our DNA that make us fully human. The only difference is that we face a different set of challenges, a different set of threats and opportunities, a different suite of tools in our toolbox to make those things a reality. So we shouldn't be surprised that civil society is continuing to evolve, always changing in many ways. But, you know, to be optimistic, people do seem to have a sort of never-ending capacity to invent new forms of collective action to suit the challenges and circumstances of the times. And every generation of citizens tries to do that in the best way that they can and find something that works. So what we're seeing now, in a sense, is no different to what was seen in the first part of the 20th century, the 1960s, the 1980s. It's just that the tools have become more sophisticated, but the people who are using them, you might say, are just as dumb or difficult or wonderful or courageous or just different and diverse as they've always been. And they will produce patterns which will surprise us, because that's what human beings do. Civil society is ultimately not a story, as I said, of technology or policies, actually. It's a vehicle, as one scholar friend puts it, for rearranging the geometry of human relations. It's a beautiful phrase, that. A vehicle for rearranging the geometry of human relations around values like compassion and respect for each other, cooperation and human dignity. One thing is clear, the key task facing all civil society groups is to get large numbers of Americans working together on huge and complex problems that are looming across the horizon: growing inequality, which none of us can get control of, increasing violence, the limits to economic growth and consumption that we will have to face at some point because we live on a finite planet with finite supplies of natural resources. If we don't work together, if we don't find new ways of working together in and through civil society, we're going to be in one almighty mess as these problems continue to pile up. But we won't succeed by going backwards in time, by being nostalgic about the past. We can only go forward by blending together the best from all the traditions I've talked about today, along with many others that haven't yet been invented in the civil societies of the future. And only then will we be able to answer the question I raised right at the beginning of my remarks: will a strong civil society be able to create societies that are strong and civil? Thanks.
Sure, like
I'm standing loud, yes. My ribs are okay.
You started your talk, and you referenced the period between the Civil War and the 1950s. Sort of bookending that period were several large phenomena that cut across American society and common enterprise, namely the Civil War, World War I, to a lesser extent the New Deal, and World War II.
Yeah.
All classes of society were affected. People came together to do things. To what extent do you think that was a byproduct of those phenomena? And do you see any ideas of some sort of a semi-compulsive national service that not necessarily focuses on the military, but on things like AmeriCorps, Peace Corps, or whatever, to again bridge those differences and force people to sort of learn again how to come together?
Well, that's a fantastic question and a really important observation. Thank you for making it. I agree those events were absolutely critical. You know, how much of cause and effect is always difficult to say. I always say it's got to be a bit of both. But clearly those events, all of them actually, I was going to say, especially the World Wars, but the New Deal as well, were, you know, tremendously powerful, dislocating, but also, as you say, re-energizing events in world history. The same happened in my country, in England. You remember after the Second World War, when a new government came in and solidified what became the welfare state, free education, free healthcare for the post-war generation, you know, still controversial in some ways. I'm a beneficiary, having had those things throughout my life. But it was made possible because of the joint sacrifices, as you were pointing out, of the war. People saw that as a good thing because we all deserve this. We've been through this together. We all, as a society, deserve a better life. And this, we think, will give it to us. So there is that sense, you know. Of course, how do you recreate it without the war? is the issue. Actually, I think there's a lot of life in New Deal type programs. Myself, I've always been a fairly optimistic proponent of wise government action, if I can put it that way. It's somewhat unpopular to argue that these days for ideological reasons, but I think there's a great deal of fiction and attacks on things like the New Deal, which we need to revisit. I think we might find that there's a lot there that we could do, actually, which would be a partial answer to your question. One suite of tools is using government as a force for the public good. It sounds sort of banal, but fairly revolutionary when you think about it. Ideas about service are also controversial, aren't they? You know, I've been part of many conversations where I've been quite surprised how they divide a room. Some people say, absolutely, you know, let's get going. You know, it's a design issue, let's just agree the details. Other people say, no, you know, that's against the voluntary spirit completely. It will take us back in time. You can't force people, you shouldn't force people to volunteer. There's a whole set of objections. And I am, I suppose, trying to be somewhat agnostic in the middle by searching for ways of launching large-scale, highly participatory processes which don't fall into those problems. Yeah, I suppose where I come out is that if we can find something that is better than the kind of AmeriCorps or Teach for America, then I would probably go for it. But both of those, I think, are quite good, but have some problems. But they are voluntary, of course. No one is forced to do that. So I think what they touch on is larger scale ideological quarrels about the role of the individual, the role of the state, what obligations we have to each other, how much those can be bureaucratized, as I was saying, or whether you just have to leave them alone and say, look, people will either do this or they won't do this for themselves. You can't push them. Not a very satisfactory answer, but it's a really, really important question that you raised. Thank you. Are you? Do you want to moderate, Sandra? Are you?
No, I'm going to ask you a question.
So am I moderating? I want to be fair here to people. Okay.
Well, Tocqueville saw us as people who formed committees and got together to mm-hmm. do things. And first of all, is it true that we were more like that than other countries? And do you think that spirit is still alive enough to be, you know, reinforced?
Well, the answer to that, like many things, is it depends how you measure it. Mm-hmm. Tocqueville was right in ranking the United States above European countries in certain forms of voluntary association. Sort of freely organized, self-governing, largely community-based organizations, town meetings and so on. A very, very traditional, very noble, if you like, form of American civil society. But of course, they were quite exclusive in many ways, in terms of race and gender. They were quite limited in many ways in terms of what they were intending to do. So one shouldn't again romanticize. But it was true those forms of association, yes, were much stronger in the United States than anywhere else. But that isn't surprising because when you think about it, the United States had broken off from England, from Great Britain. And therefore there was a tremendous both need and willingness to self-organize, right? Because we're creating a new society. and how do you create a new society? Well, part of that is government, but part of that is civil society. How do you do things for yourselves? How do you do things in that community? How do you organize and make decisions as a collective? So it's not surprising that having taken that path, you would find an explosion of those kinds of association. Whereas, of course, in Europe, we were quite backward in those terms, and we're still laboring under kings and queens and monarchs and hierarchies of all different kinds. On the other hand, even in medieval England, of course, you had large numbers of civil society organisations. This is the measurement question, like guilds, professional groups and so on, or geographical-based organisations. The Peasants' Revolt, which is what I opened my civil society book with, was in 1381, for goodness sake, one of the earliest civil society formations, when John Ball stood on Blackheath in London and declared, if you like, the first civic republic in England, and of course was executed a couple of days later. It didn't last very long, but he was doing his best to revive, to initiate that idea that there could be something different than a monarchy, and it would look something like a civil society, a self-governing society. So yes and no. You know, I think it's important that we don't, homogenize this too much to say, well, only these kinds of groups, you know, qualify for membership in civil society, because that's, I think, too exclusive. On the other hand, we have to be aware, as I said, that they all have very different characteristics. You wouldn't use a rake, you know, to dig a field, so you wouldn't use a town hall meeting, probably to abolish slavery, you know what I mean? You'd need a campaign, an advocacy group, a social movement. There was a question here.
Yeah. Just ask you to shift your focus from some of the broader trends that you talked about, more specifically to community, and even more specifically to our community.
Mm-hmm.
And the question has to do with, or the observation has to do with, the distinction between systemic issues and things like symptoms or charity, and the way advocacy groups approach those two things. In our community, it seems that it's very comfortable to look at symptoms. For example, we could take the issue of hunger, a byproduct of poverty, and take that issue. And we would find that there's broad support and a great deal of comfort in responding to issues of hunger. We see it all over all the time, food drives and so forth. But as those needs continue to expand, the question is, do we not have a responsibility to shift some of that energy, the advocacy, towards systemic issues, the look at structural injustice, looking at actually at our institutions of education, all of those institutions, and whether we really, if we don't do that, as the needs continue to grow, whether we don't, even as the check writers and the contributors, don't we become complicit in that very process? And the reason I ask that question is because my experience has been that when you shift from becoming a giver or a charity giver or participation in charity and looking at symptoms, and you try and shift some of the energy over into looking at root causes, it becomes very uncivil. So I'm moving from trend to our community, but it's characteristic, I think, of many communities. Is the reason people are turning away is because it's so uncivil when you move the energy from the symptom to the root cause.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great both question and observation. Well, I think you're absolutely, absolutely right. This is not a symptom, not an issue in Scranton alone, as you say. It's a universal, actually, observation. Let's start with the fact that is a fact, I think, that you're right, that we may well agree on goals, but not on means, on methods. So we do agree that hunger is a bad thing and should be abolished, but we don't agree on how to do that. That's where the very vociferous disagreements are, because it's about the role of government versus the role of the market, what business should or shouldn't do, what people should do for themselves as opposed to the state. And there's a whole bundle of issues which are deeply ideological for different people, on which we will never agree. I used to think that we will agree, actually, if we're only nicer to each other, and we talked and talked and talked, we would eventually agree, but I don't think that any longer. I think those differences are sort of hardwired, and in some ways, to be accepted as natural, because we're just very different. That doesn't change the next part of my answer to your question, just as an observation. So I don't think the solution to it, if you like, is classic negotiation, dialogue building, deliberation. Because at the end of the day, you and I are not going to agree on everything. It's just impossible, and perhaps unhealthy, actually, given that we're wonderfully creative human beings. So I think what is important to say, though, is that civil society is not just about giving and never has been. It is about trying to find some common ground despite those differences. In other words, you know, we tend to overemphasize these days, as you say, giving as a methodology as opposed to acting in a certain way. And we tend to prioritize symptoms because they're easy to deal with and causes. Okay, so let's take that. But civil society was never ever about giving solely, never ever defined in terms of philanthropy or charity or NGOs. It came from a particular way of living and being in the world, a certain set of responsibilities as a good citizen. The first person to talk about civil society was Aristotle. And for him, civil society meant a society where citizens accepted the obligations of being a citizen, of turning up, of getting things done, of making decisions democratically. And yes, you were a woman or a slave, of course. So Aristotle was not particularly inclusive, but you know what I mean. That's the origin, the long-buried origin of all of these ideas. It's about who we are as people and what obligations we have towards one another. It's as simple as that. So do we want to use those obligations constructively to address the question that you put on the table? A civil society would say yes, absolutely, but not because we're going to agree on them at the level of methods. But what we will do is agree, first of all, common ground on the goals, and secondly, more common ground on the means than we had before. But I'm never going to believe that government is effective. This is me putting a mask on. Me, as an anti-government activist, I'm never going to accept that a large-scale food stamps program is an effective way of combating hunger. You will never get me to accept that, however much I love you. You see where I'm going?
Yeah.
So I don't think that's a defeatist answer, but I'm trying to be give an honest one, which is to say the differences are not going to go away. The friction can be managed. You don't have to shout at each other. And you'll be able to tackle a larger proportion of the problem than you would have done before, if you follow those steps. And in Scranton, wherever else, you know. I mean, we have a set of things, and my wife is standing for election this evening as the County Election Commissioner for the Democrats in Sullivan County. And so she's been campaigning the last 2 weeks, and it's been horrific, you know, in terms of abuse, vitriol, knives in the back, you know, just unbelievable stuff. In a county, you know, a tiny county, 60,000 people. You think, well, it's 60,000 children, you know, that's what it seems like, we're living amidst 60,000 sort of kids in the playground. And so I know exactly what you mean. You can't talk about anything. You know, it's just impossible. But she keeps going.
Yeah. So the question is,
she keeps going.
Are you an optimist in terms of what's becoming more civil, or on the basis of what you said, probably less civil as we shift our energies more toward looking at the systemic causes of the problems that we claim we want?
I don't think we've hit rock bottom yet for structural reasons, because inequality is going to continue. Therefore, anxiety is going to increase, fear is going to be mobilized. There's a whole lot of bad stuff coming our way. But I am an optimist that the curve will, yes, rise back up at some point, because I believe that's our true nature as human beings. We're not actually born or made to shout at each other and be greedy and selfish and so on. We're born in a different image. That's my sort of spiritual side coming through, but I do believe it. And eventually that will come through, as it has in periods of the past when we've been able to do things together.
Yes,
sir. Okay.
There is a new movie by Michael Moore, Where to Invade Next.
Yes.
And I was wondering what you think the influence of such a movie would be on our society. I mean, to me, it seemed so utopic. How could that possibly be? But it's a documentary. And I'm European myself.
Yeah, so well, I'm with you, so am I. I don't know, I haven't seen the movie. I've read mixed reviews of it,
well,
to be honest.
Everybody should see it.
Okay, well, number one, we'll all see it. I don't know, you know, I mean, Michael Moore's movies I quite like, but I'm not sure they've been a major influence in American society or any film house, to be honest. It's interesting, you know, sometimes when you try to be didactic, you end up with less influence than if you try to entertain people with a subtle message. And Moore's films, of course, are very didactic. And maybe that is a quote. I suppose going back to what I was saying, for me that's about this balance between strong bonds, you know, strongly identified communities who passionately believe one thing, as opposed to looser bonds, where you are reaching out to someone who you know will disagree with you and saying, is there something we can do together? Because usually when you go to a Michael Moore film, you either agree with it, you either love it or you hate it. And that's okay. You know, as I said, that can be very important in building a movement. But you can't rebuild society by building a movement. They're different tasks. They require different things. So I will go and see it. But I reserve judgment, I suppose, is what I will say. Yes.
Ellen DeGeneres ends her programs by saying, be kind.
Right. Yes. And of course, you remember someone said after Princess Diana's funeral in England, the art of being kind is all this world needs. And it does, you're absolutely right. I'm with you all the way. And Transformation, my magazine, is based on that philosophy. Our tagline is where love meets social justice. And so we publish articles which show how people can combine the best sense of themselves with radical action to improve society through love, kindness, compassion, connection, and so on. So the rest of my life is actually devoted to spreading that philosophy, less successfully than Ellen, unfortunately. The question it raises, though, you know, so we shouldn't be romantic about these things, we should be rigorous. So what does it mean, you know, when you translate it into the reality of a factory or a government department or a university or a church or a mosque, whatever it is, what does it mean? How does it play out? Yeah.
I rarely watch television, but one time I was having my car service, and it was on.
Okay.
She had a child, I don't know how old she was, 10, roughly, who heard her message and decided that there were children that didn't have books. And she decided that she was going to get books to send to places where there were no books.
Good. That's a great example.
So, and I'm sure she's not the only one. I mean, people are hearing this message and they are acting on it. We just don't hear it.
Yes and no, I would say. I disagree with you a bit on that. Because yes, there are lots of those sort of wonderful individual examples of service and so on. But you show me where there is an economy of kindness. Show me where there is a political process governed by compassion.
You know? But it has to start somewhere.
I'm not saying it doesn't have to start somewhere, but it has to grow and face up to those larger realities. We can do, and this is not a criticism at all, we can do the easier things, and we should do them because they're right in front of us, but only if they're connected to the more difficult ones. So a lot of what we're doing on Transformation is to show people what an economy of kindness would do, how would it function, what happens to the details, prices, competition, what kind of products would you produce, how would you produce them, what about wages, you know. Because unless you can answer those questions at that level of detail, you know, the message of kindness is left sort of there as a wonderful message, but I do business as usual tomorrow. So I'm not knocking it at all, but I do think there's a bigger task that we have to commit to, maybe a future Schemel forum to talk about this. You know, let's get real about economies and politics of kindness and so on and start showing each other how they would actually operate with real examples, I mean.
Yeah, I just am beginning to resent the whole phrase common ground, find common ground, because what has become common ground has become so reduced. That's why nothing gets accomplished, etc.
Right.
In those organizations you talked about that worked so well, it would seem to me that they didn't reach just common ground. They had to compromise and agree to things that they didn't agree, they wouldn't necessarily like. And it seems like because those organizations that needed that have faded, we're left with a structure that talks about if we reach common ground, we'll agree, but if we can't reach common ground, then we'll go home and alcohol.
Yeah, no, that's a very fair point and a very important point. You know, I think what does happen if you have a contest, particularly among unequals, is that the common ground either gets pushed in one direction by the more powerful set of interests, or shrunk, as you say, as to something that's almost meaningless. Or we'll find common ground in something that's so unimportant that I'll stop fighting just because I can't be bothered, you know, who cares? So it's not about passing a GI Bill or the New Deal or the welfare state or anything like that. I think there are two answers to that. One is to try and make this process more of a contest of equals, so that you're expanding the common ground, not contracting it. And second is to have that as a specific objective. You know, there are lots of groups now, search for common ground, or those horrible, use the words again, I apologize. But, you know, there are groups now who have developed quite sophisticated methodologies for trying to protect and enhance real, quite broad common ground in very contentious issues. Otherwise people start to kill each other, you know. So I think there's some hope in that community. There are sort of 17, 18 organizations now who specialize in that sort of area. More broadly, though, I think that's a case of pushing back against the manipulation of an idea, which remains very valuable, and saying, you know, there's a reality here to reach for, despite the reality that we actually have in front of us. So the problem is not common ground or the idea of common ground. It's a much deeper set of political polarization or selfishness or fear-mongering or whatever it is that's closing the common ground, as you say, which is an accurate observation. So I haven't given a hope, but I do sometimes talk to people who say all this common ground stuff, you know, it's so rosy and romantic and rosy-tinted. You don't understand, Mike, the realities of what it's like to be on the front lines in America, the front lines of a struggle, or to have three jobs, you know, to pay the rent or whatever. It's way too rosy-tinted and romantic. And I do take that seriously. I think, you know, a lot of what I talk about is from a relative position of comfort and security. And traditionally, civil society operated on that basis, you know. Where you have broad-based economic security, you can create a very vibrant civil society because people have time and energy and resources and everything else. When you're on the margin, it's much more difficult. So I think that's a good, you know, thing to bear in mind, to stop ourselves, you know, going too far into the rosy-tinted haze where everything is nice and harmonious.
It just seems compromise requires more than common ground.
It does, yeah.
Common ground plus, I will agree to things that I might not want, but to push the ball forward.
Yes, so you know, so we will agree to large-scale redistributive government action for the next 15 years. Essentially what happened in the 40s and the 50s, yeah, you know, to swallow that. But I think part of that is because you see the benefits. You know, if you see benefits flowing back, you tend to change your mind a little bit more than if you don't. There's one final question over here.
Yes.
I would just like you to talk a bit about this language that we have reserved to, about using those little smiley faces and those frowns.
Emoticons.
It seems that whole social media is so limited in conversation anyway, and then people will decide that they're going to use, and I understand they're coming up with a whole new vocabulary as well, and it frightens me that we have this wonderful language of words and phrases, and that we will be, there's this move to reduce it to smiley faces or frowns. That's very
crazy. Shakespeare on Twitter, as someone said to me. You only have 140 characters, Shakespeare. Okay. So tell us about Romeo and Juliet. Yeah, it is a bit scary, but you know, it's going to keep on because it's convenient and cheap and easy and exciting and fun. All those things that the Lions and the Rotary and so on are no longer. I'm talking a bit sort of lackadaisically here, but you know, in a sense, it goes back to my point about, and I'll close here, point on complementarity versus substitution. All of that stuff to me is okay. Go and enjoy it, you know, go forth and multiply, but don't leave the other stuff behind. You can be both efficient on social media and write wonderful plays and books and everything else. You don't have to substitute one for the other.
Well, first of all, I think you'll notice, Michael, that we have a quite nice conversation here, and we do this as often as we can in our seminars. I wanted to, before closing, tell you that this is Michael's book, The Oxford Handbook of Civil Society, and because we're the special audience that we are, this book is can be had for $20 from the original what?
150.
There's some out on the table, and we hope that you'll like it because I think your interest in civil societies profound and enhanced today by Michael being with us. Thank you.